It's my pleasure to be with you today and to share this session with my colleague Mohammed Sanhoui. I think we are complementary to each other. First of all, the normal left atrial function is as a reservoir during systole, conduit, during early filling, contractile function during late filling phase, and the new hormonal function during periods of atrial stretch. Atrial fibrillation and heart failure are common epidemics, and the atrial fibrillation can promote heart failure through the rapid rate, irregular rhythm, presence of mitral and tricuspid regurgitation leading to tachycardiomyopathy, and heart failure could lead to atrial fibrillation through the left atrial dilation, fibrosis, abnormal handling of calcium, and the new hormonal activation. The presence of atrial fibrillation, regardless of the cause of each heart failure or atrial fibrillation who cause each other, the presence of atrial fibrillation is accompanied by poor outcome regarding worsening of heart failure, hospitalization, and mortality. Both could lead to each other and could lead to deterioration of the left atrial systolic function and left atrial distensibility and lead to abnormal new hormonal activation, perpetuating heart failure, more heart failure, and more atrial fibrillation. The guidelines recommending ablation, catheter ablation for atrial fibrillation in tachycardiomyopathy as class 1 recommendation and in patients with reduced ejection fraction as class 2A. The data from clinical trials are a little bit conflicting. For example, the Castle AF, as Mohammed mentioned, leads to reduction in the mortality, significant reduction in the mortality, and significant reduction in heart failure hospitalization. And they recommend catheter ablation to reduce mortality and hospitalization in patients with heart failure. But if we look carefully to the demographic criteria in Castle AF, we will find that the percentage of patients with NEHA 3 to 4 heart failure is less than 30%. So the majority are in NEHA 2 heart failure patients. The type of heart atrial fibrillation is paroxysmal in 1/3 of the patients, and the long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation is only 30% of these patients. So less advanced forms of heart failure and less durable atrial fibrillation. The type of ablation in Castle AF, it was allowed in 50% of patients to do more additional ablation line beyond pulmonary vein isolation. And 1/4 of these patients underwent a redo procedure, not a single procedure for pulmonary vein isolation. Also, rhythm control strategy was allowed in the medically treated arm, which could cause more proarrhythmia and increasing the mortality. In a subgroup analysis of which patient benefited from catheter ablation in the Castle AF, it was found that patients with secondary ICD did not benefit from catheter ablation, which means more advanced patients with heart failure will not benefit from catheter ablation. Also, there was a trend towards less outcome in patients older than 65. Also, NEHA 3 heart failure did not show a significant benefit. Those with ejection fraction less than 25, as Mohammed mentioned, did not benefit from atrial fibrillation. The more advanced the heart failure is, the less expected benefit from catheter ablation. 2 months ago, a study or an intention to treat analysis from the Castle AF to show us who would benefit from catheter ablation, it showed that those in NEHA 2 heart failure showed a significant benefit in mortality and heart failure hospitalization compared to NEHA 3 and 4. And they showed 2 important issues that are associated with improvement in the function, ejection fraction, non-ischemic etiology, and NEHA functional class 2. So if your patient is in NEHA 3 and 4 heart failure, not expected to improve his ejection fraction, and the ischemic cardiomyopathy not expected to improve as ejection fraction. And they concluded that heart failure patients are a heterogeneous group, and ablation should be offered at early stage, especially in NEHA 2 and non-ischemic patient. On the contrary, the AMICA trial, which compared the catheter ablation to best medical treatment, assigned patients with ejection fraction less than 35, 1-to-1 for ablation versus best medical treatment. And they found there was no significant difference between catheter ablation and the medical treatment regarding ejection fraction improvement. And they concluded that catheter ablation is not beneficial in improvement in ejection fraction in those with long-standing resistant atrial fibrillation. But why they are different? Because they use different primary endpoints. the castle for hospitalization and mortality, while the amica for the ejection fraction improvement. The other, that the improvement noted in the castle AF occurred in the second and third year follow-up, not in the first year. Also, the demographics were different. Amica had a more advanced reduction in the systolic function, 100% persistent atrial fibrillation, and higher grade of NIHA 3 to 4 heart failure, and more patients are receiving ICD and CRT, so they are sicker patients. And this table summarizes the trials in patients with heart failure and AF ablation. In the CAMERA MRI trial, there was no improvement in ejection fraction in those with pre-existing fibrosis as assessed by cardiac MRI, with no effect on the mortality. In the ARC heart failure, no significant improvement in ejection fraction assessed by radionuclide imaging, and no benefit on mortality. While in the CASEL, they reported improvement in the mortality, but 20% of these patients were not included in primary analysis, and patients treated with medical therapy received antiarrhythmic drugs that worsened the mortality. Also, the ATTACK AF trial showed improvement in the ejection fraction and fewer deaths in the catheter ablation group. The CAMTEF reported also increasing ejection fraction assessed by echo with no effect on the mortality. The McDonald trials reported the patient with the worst ejection fraction, around 18%, and assessed the improvement in function using MRI, and it showed no improvement in ejection fraction and no improvement in the mortality. So, could atrial fibrillation, ablation, and heart failure be harmful? We know that ablation will lead to myocyte loss and its replacement by fibrous tissue. Those with minimal pre-existing fibrosis will heal without sequelae, but patients with advanced heart failure and long-standing resistant atrial fibrillation have severe underlying fibrosis. This will need extensive ablation and will heal by more fibrous tissue. And this will lead to 30% scarring in the left atrium, 40 to 70% reduction systolic function, 40% loss of atrial distensibility, and increase in the left atrial pressure, loss of myocytes, and the reduction of PNP level, and up to 10% risk of development of what's called stiff left atrial syndrome, and this will be associated with very high grade of recurrence. Do we expect truly that AF ablation will be durable in patients with heart failure? Left atrial size, volume, sphericity index, presence of diastolic dysfunction, worsening mitral regurgitation, and the pre-existing fibrosis, all these will lead to more advanced stages and more high risk of recurrence. In a study that evaluated the presence, the effect of left atrial volume index on catheter ablation success, it was found that patients with more reduced ejection fraction, patients with dilated left ventricular diastolic dimension, dilated left atrium, either dimension or volume index, those with diastolic dysfunction, tricuspid regurgitation, pulmonary hypertension, all these were associated with very high rate of recurrence. The effect of the left atrial geometry, the presence of a spherical left atrium assessed by cardiac MRI as the sphericity index, this will lead to very high rate of recurrence, especially when associated with enlarged left atrial volume index. Also, the presence of mitral regurgitation was found to be a predictor of AF recurrence because these patients have a low voltage zones that will be disposed to atrial fibrillation recurrence. The presence of left atrial fibrosis assessed by MRI will lead to a high rate of recurrence as they classified it according to the OTA stages. Those with OTA stage 3 and 4 have a very high risk of atrial fibrillation recurrence after ablation. Also, the severity of atrial fibrosis after ablation is associated with atrial fibrillation recurrence and stroke risk. To summarize, the association between heart failure and AF beyond the electrical basis only. Ablation outcome affected by the presence of left atrial dilatation, diastolic dysfunction, mitral regurgitation, pulmonary hypertension. The more extensive ablation we need, the more worsening of the left atrial function and atrial myopathy, and also the recurrence. Ablation in heart failure need more well-designed trials with harder endpoint. Ablation in heart failure should be individualized. And we suppose in patients with suspected tachymyopathy to proceed for catheter ablation. If not, we should offer catheter ablation in young patients in the earlier stages of heart failure with NIHA 1 and 2, fewer comorbidities, not markedly dilated left atrium, minimal or no late gadolinium enhancement in MRI with recent onset atrial fibrillation. If failed medical treatment in those groups, so we should proceed for catheter ablation or avinodal ablation and biventricular pacing. And thank you.
Thank you very much on behalf of all the chairmen sitting here. Before I ask my question, I would like to say how proud we are of the younger generation of Egyptian cardiologists, I mean, from Alexandria and also from Cairo and from any other part of Egypt. It's really, and it makes us very happy to know that cardiology is improving. You're better than we were when we were your age. My question to you is, you know, as a non-electrophysiologist, but as a person who really treats a lot of heart failure and a lot of heart failure with atrial fibrillation, I think one of the big problems about the clinical trials is they try to find a one-size-fits-all solution, which doesn't work. We need tailored treatment and precision medicine. So if I ask both of you in two words to give us a consensus on which are the best heart failure patients with atrial fibrillation, you already said that, but I want you to summarize it. Which are the best heart failure patients with atrial fibrillation who would really benefit from ablation, and which are the patients on the other side whom we should not ablate, just leave them in atrial fibrillation? Yeah, I think he, yeah. You can just summarize it. You don't have
the slide. In patient, if we suppose that the patient, yes, this algorithm, in patient we suspected to have an atrial fibrillation induced cardiomyopathy, it's a class one recommendation. We should proceed first for catheter ablation. If we have heart failure that was complicated by atrial fibrillation, so we should start at very early stage when the left atrium is not markedly dilated, and the patient is still in NEHA 1 or NEHA 2 heart failure, not in the NEHA 3. Beyond NEHA 3, we have a high rate of recurrence and poor outcomes. Ejection fraction was not significantly dropped because if ejection fraction is less than 25, we have a poor prognosis even with catheter ablation. Patient should be assessed not only by echo, but also by cardiac MRI. If we have minimal fibrosis in the left atrium, less than 10%, we can proceed for atrial fibrillation ablation. If we don't have a significant mitral regurge, severe diastolic dysfunction, pulmonary hypertension, because all this is predictor for poor outcome, poor predictor of recurrence. So earlier stages, younger patient, recent onset heart failure, recent onset atrial fibrillation, especially when paroxysmal. If it is a long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation, as Mohammed showed in his slide, he will not benefit from atrial fibrillation.
Thank you. Do you agree, Dr. Sanhouri?
Yes, I want to add some point. There is a very important point. If we restore sinus rhythm in some patients with heart failure and he did not respond regarding ejection fraction or symptoms, this patient should be kept on medical rate control strategy if AF recurred again. Again, if the patient after catheter ablation, whether catheter ablation failed or the patient have recurrence after catheter ablation, we should shift and forget about AF ablation and shift to the rate control strategy, considering the CRT and AV nodal ablation. This contradictory to Ahmed said that NEHA 1, 2 should be referred for ablation. NEHA 3 or more, or patient very thick with very advanced heart failure state, we should start with the rate control strategy not to think about the rhythm control strategy.
Thank you very much. This is a great answer.
I have a question. Come on, Ablin Soal, congratulations for the presentation. Very good presentation.
Thank you.
My question is about paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. What we can do with heart failure with paroxysmal atrial fibrillation?
Yes. First of all, if the patient has paroxysmal self-terminating atrial fibrillation, for example, we should stick to, or we should do like the guidelines tell us. If the patient have paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, which is highly recurrent and does not respond despite the use of at least one antiarrhythmic drug, we should refer this patient for catheter ablation. But if the patient have only one paroxysm, for example, of atrial fibrillation, which is self-terminated, I keep him on medical treatment only.
Dr. Hazem. Thank you very much. It's an amazing presentation from young cardiologist Alex, cardiology department. I'd like to ask about the base patient, patient with CRTD. What is the role of ablation, atrial fibrillation, paroxysmal, persistent in base patient? What is the data?
The benefits, Dr. Hazem, the benefits of CRT is met when the patient approach close to 98% biventricular pacing. The problem in patients with atrial fibrillation that we have around 70 to 80% sinus rhythm and around 70 to 80% biventricular pacing. In this case scenario, we have to improve the biventricular pacing, either by trying it medically or by ablation. And you have two options, either to isolate the pulmonary veins, it will be hard to maintain the sinus rhythm in this patient, or better to ablate the AV node as a part of the rate control, non-pharmacological rate control strategy. So we ablate the AV node and depend only on biventricular pacing.
Thank you.
And thank you. أنا بس عندي سؤال نايف شوية. AF induced cardiomyopathy, PVC induced cardiomyopathy. احنا عارفين كويس قوي ان ممكن الكارديوميوباثي في حد ذاته يبقى معاه very frequent PVCs. وممكن الاتريال فيبريليشن تحصل نتيجة الكارديوميوباثي. How can I reach a diagnosis that this is probably due to AF induced cardiomyopathy? لو في حاجة تانية غير الهيستوري تساعدني ولا هو بس الهيستوري؟
No,
long standing.
Yes, this is a retrograde diagnosis. After we restore the sinus rhythm, if the left ventricular function is improved and returns back to normal, I'll diagnose retrogradely AF-induced cardiomyopathy. The same like PVCs. If I suppress the PVCs with medical treatment or with ablation and the ejection fraction improved, usually in few months it returned back to normal, I'll diagnose retrogradely PVC-induced cardiomyopathy. So it is a retrograde diagnosis, not anterograde diagnosis.
Anyhow, thank you very much, both of you. يعني نبتدي and jump to the second session.